Aldred is speaking, yes. It's 25 years since I first visited your planet.
Well, what do you reckon? Things more peaceful? Quieter? Calmer now?
Well...
Going into its 25th anniversary season, Doctor Who was still on a war footing. The battle may have been won, but the show, having survived the firing of the 6th Doctor Colin Baker, and the now former controller of BBC One Michael Grade, having now left his position for a role at Channel 4. However, his replacement would be his right-hand man, Jonathan Powell, and as such, the series was still broadcast on Wednesday afternoons against the massively popular Coronation Street. Though despite this, Doctor Who did do surprisingly well, managing to pull in over 6 million viewers on occasion against the soap opera's regular nearly 20 million. And that wasn't all for British TV science fiction at the time, with the goofy sci-fi comedy Red Dwarf that would go on to celebrate great success in the 90s, getting its first two seasons broadcast in this year of 1988. There was also evidence that Doctor Who was still around in the public zeitgeist, as in June 1988, the song Doctor in the TARDIS by the KLF, or the Time Lords as they were known at the time, managed to hit number one on the charts. And around the later part of the year, Wartime was released, a straight-to-video production made in the vein of the audio-visuals, which were essentially fan films made in the 80s. This was the first licensed production of the show, and as such, they managed to hire John Levine to return for the role of Sergeant John Benton for one last time. Whilst this production may have been, well, crap, with a nonsensical half-hour story that screams R/IM14 and This Is Deep, delving into Sergeant Benton's childhood traumas and his memories of World War II. It did pave the way for future licensed productions by Real Time and BBV that would, in part, keep the show alive through the 90s. It is also notable the contribution of Nicholas Briggs, who would go on to be a very successful voice actor, co-founder of Big Finish Productions and the voice of many of the monsters of the revival series. Despite being pushed back a month by the Olympics, meaning the series would run into 1989, Doctor Who's 25th season premiered on the 5th of October 1988, and its opening story, Remembrance of the Daleks. Remembrance is to this day a fan favourite, appearing on many top 10 and must-watch lists. This is not just because of its masses of Dalek action, pyrotechnics and new special effects. Yes, that was the first skeletal extermination. And yes, that's a flying Dalek. But this marked a new era for Doctor Who. It's Renaissance. Remembrance was Cartmell's first proper crack at creatively leading Doctor Who, so he introduced his first hints towards the Cartmell Master Plan, which would be heavily expanded on in the novelisation. This and The Curse of Fenric would be what bridged the gap between the Target novelisations and the Virgin New Adventures. Whilst at this point it likely wasn't fully planned out where this would go, one thing was clear from this deleted scene, that the Doctor was...
I am far more than just another Time Lord.
Adding the mystery back into Doctor Who. This story was also our first proper Ace story, and boy did she make an impact. Firing RPGs and destroying a Dalek with a baseball bat, all while still remaining a grounded everyday teenage girl, this was clearly a character to be reckoned with. McCoy's Doctor performance also massively changed since his previous season 24. Having been denounced as a miscast, McCoy now wanted to prove that he was right for the role, so it added a much more darker and dramatic angle to his performance, creating a Doctor much more sociopathic than his predecessors. Talking a Dalek into killing itself and genociding an entire species in an act that may have sparked the Time War. All in a story that ends with a funeral, the flimsy light fun of the mid-80s Who was now well and truly gone. This story is often considered to be the pseudo 25th anniversary story rather than the real anniversary special we'll get onto later. with it featuring not Ian, Barbara and Susan in Coal Hill School and not the Brigadier, who would all go on to be in the Big Finish series Countermeasures, as well as also a comics-accurate Dalek Emperor who, plot twist, turns out to be Davros. With this also being the third and final part of the Dalek Civil War trilogy that had been playing throughout the 80s. But most of all is its November 1963 setting. Not shying away from its social commentary, this story makes a parallel between the Daleks, which were always an allegory for fascist Nazism, and the racist attitudes of the 1960s. As Ace so eloquently put it,
"Renegade Daleks are blobs. Well, you can tell that Daleks are into racial purity. So one lot of Daleks reckon that the other lot of blobs are too different, not pure in their blobbiness.
Result?
Water to death."
It's hard to believe Doctor Who was a show as old as the civil rights movement, and the writer, son of a communist activist Ben Aaronovitch, did not shy away from this political message. This is so explicitly shown in a scene where a number of characters have just had a lovely breakfast and Ace looks in the window to find a no-coloured sign, in a room that only the night before had watched possibly or possibly not the new BBC science fiction show, Doctor Who. On reflection, the producers and director Andrew Morgan wished they had shown her tear up the sign. The political nature of Doctor Who was nothing new. The Daleks were allegories for Nazism going back to their creation in the 60s. Silurians are Native Americans, Sontarans are the military-industrial complex, and so on. There are so many examples of classic Who stories that are blatant political attacks, such as the mining industry and the Green Death, the Doctor quoting Marx as to start a revolution against the Callaghan parody regime in The Sunmakers, the Peladon Alliance being the EU, etc. And it's the same for the revival as well, with Aliens of London being an Iraq War commentary to the point of literally quoting Blair, the Trump parody of Jack Robinson in the Whittaker era, capitalism being the villain in Oxygen, and let's not forget the Seventh Doctor died of American healthcare. Doctor Who has always been a vessel for criticising the ruling government, except not in John Nathan Turner's eyes. He once said, "The most political Doctor Who it can be is the green aliens and the blue aliens don't get along." This partly caused the stagnation of the show in the mid-80s, and it wasn't taking any risks. However, during his job interview for the new script editor, Andrew Cartmell was asked what he would do with the show if he could, and he bluntly said, "Bring down Thatcher." And that leads us on to the next story, Graham Curry's The Happiness Patrol. This story is remembered as the one where Sheila Hancock plays a blatant Mark Thatcher parody, the evil Helen A, a role she accepted because of her hatred for the Prime Minister. This story went right against Thatcher, with gay undertones and her husband leaving her with another man in the face of Section 28. There's class segregation, police brutality, registration of immigrants and even capital punishment, all in the name of happiness. This story depicts a dark, evil, sadistic, authoritarian police state, painted up to appear pleasant and lying to itself that it's for the people's own good. This can most clearly be shown by the iconic monster of the week, the Candyman, a robot made out of sweets who is the chief torturer and executioner. This insane design has been used to mock Classic Who, often by people who have only seen images of it and not the actual context of the story. Bassett Sweets weren't very happy with the similarity between the Candyman and the Licorice Man, so the BBC ensured them that the character would never return, making this the one villain that we can say for sure won't come back to your screens. There are also these weird sewer dwellers who are never really explained, and the episode suddenly takes a turn when the Doctor manipulates a sniper into dropping his gun.
Makes sense, doesn't it?
Yes.
A life killing life.
Who are you?
Shut up. Why don't you do it then? Look me in the eye. Pull the trigger. End my life.
But on top of its scathing criticism of the government, this story can also be interpreted as encouraging freedom of expression. The sad, melancholy blues can be seen as just as enjoyable as empty, bright, positive happiness. That everyone's sad sometimes and there's nothing to stop it. It should be embraced. This could be seen as a criticism of the BBC itself in the 80s that had been neutering shows such as Doctor Who to fit in with the bland, positive narrative that was trying to be pushed by the higher-ups. But on top of the camp, pink brightness of this serial, it makes a lot of use of blues motifs, using harmonica music and the dark alleyways of the city. After filming, McCoy was annoyed to hear that there were plans to film it in black and white to add to this theme, which he thought would have covered up the quite shoddy set work. It must be said that the city they used in the story does make the world feel rather small, like everything is happening in one street. This serial performed moderately well, averaging around 5 million viewers, only slightly behind the previous Remembrance. It had a tepid response from fans over the coming years, but critically has been looked back on with a lot of praise and has become an iconic piece of classic Who, even if not many people have seen it, and the go-to example of political messaging in popular media. In 2011, this story would be referenced in the Archbishop of Canterbury's Easter address. So whilst it may not be a fan favourite or a central piece of Doctor Who, The Happiness Patrol is now regarded as a solid story in what would shape up to be a beloved season. However, this such reappraisal hasn't really happened to the following story quite yet.
Cybermen.
The 25th anniversary celebration of Doctor Who, with its first episode being broadcast on the 23rd of November 1988, Silver Nemesis by Kelvin Clark looks towards the future of the show, whereas Remembrance had looked to the past, or at least it does in the extended VHS version that was released a few years later. It treats the Doctor as a more mysterious figure with a lot of secret history.
Doctor?
We don't know when or how he previously encountered the Nemesis, much like with the Hand of Omega in Remembrance and Fenric in the following years, The Curse of Fenric, and this was very much the direction they wanted to take the show in. The story itself, however, is a pretty straightforward runaround, with a group of Nazis calling themselves the Fourth Reich and a couple from the 17th century, the Doctor and Ace, and for some reason Cybermen, who are only there for no reason other than it being a silver anniversary and could frankly have been replaced with another generic alien villain. This story isn't actually as bad as its reputation makes out. It's got its moments, such as Ace taking on Cybermen with only a slingshot and a pouch of gold coins, or the jazz concert at the beginning, and it was filmed on what is now the site of the O2 Arena. It's structured oddly, with a lot of quick time jumps where needed, but in all it doesn't do too much with its three episodes. Frankly, it could have fared much better in the modern 45-minute single episode format, but it is what it is, and it's best enjoyed as just a story rather than the 25th anniversary special. Also, there's a Queen cameo in it. Don't know why, but a Queen Elizabeth impressionist is briefly seen in it during a part of the runaround at Windsor Castle, where we see the Doctor wearing a fez.
Fez, I wear a fez now. Fezzes are cool.
Oh! The final part of season 25 nearly never happened at all. The BBC studios they were due to film in was found to have asbestos, so any filming had to be halted. Getting flashbacks to the previously cancelled serial Sharda, John Nathan Turner set out to make sure history wouldn't repeat itself. So in order to complete this serial, a circus tent was put up in the car park at Elstree Studios to accommodate all the interior filming. It's a testament to the endurance of Doctor Who that despite budget cuts and against all the obstacles, they still pulled together to make the show they're so passionate for. And thank God they did.
Acts of all kind, and you can count on that. From folks that fly to disappearing acts, there are lots of surprises for the family at the greatest show in the galaxy. So many strange surprises, I'm prepared to bet whatever you've seen before. You ain't seen nothing yet.
The greatest show in the galaxy is very much a story like no other. It feels very empty, with half the story in a desert and half in an all but abandoned circus. It's all a metaphor for the show itself. A circus act that was once beloved, the greatest in the galaxy, has now been reduced to a husk of its former self, performers being forced to repeat their tired acts, one of their few customers being a bespectacled obsessive fan, and only being produced to meet the satisfaction of the gods of Ragnarok, who hold the power of life and death over them all, or rather a family TV audience. Even has a discount doctor-like traveller with a young girl companion, all adding to just how meta this story is. Written by Stephen Ryott, who also did the previous year's Paradise Towers, which was also a pretty thematic story, though executed pretty poorly, shall we say, it has to be said for sure that Ryott is a conceptual writer, but this can only work when produced well, and director Alan Wearing definitely did it justice, unlike the previous work. The aesthetics and theme of Greatest Show are what make it stand out. It doesn't have much in the way of action or grand special effects, well, except for the exploding wind machine at the end. Hats off to McCoy, by the way, for not flinching despite his jacket catching fire. but rather it's a psychological horror with a character who has been mentally broken, and with the henchmen being creepy clowns, with the lead clown played by Ian Reddington, who broke his jaw in this outtake. Yeah, this production was cursed, wasn't it? The story itself doesn't really get going until the latter half and is rather unsure of itself, suddenly jumping to this mystical explanation of what's going on. But really, who cares? It is what it wants to be, a beautifully unnerving serial that is all a metaphor for the state of the show. And we get to see McCoy doing proper clown and magician work for trying to distract gods, blending the jester and sadistic sides of the Seventh Doctor. And what a way to end off the 25th anniversary celebrations of Doctor Who, even if it did spill into January 1989. This 25th season was a massive turning point for the show. After its years of decline, this was often referred to as the beginning of the Renaissance for the show. And it showed, managing to cross over 6 million viewers with Silver Nemesis Part 1 and The Greatest Show Part 2. The show was in recovery. Was. Unfortunately, this renaissance would prove to be just one last hurrah for Doctor Who.
25 years?
Yes.
Time for a rest.
Time to get started. Come on, Ace.